Greetings once again to everyone. And thank you once again to everyone here for your attendance and for your participation in our conference today. My job is very straightforward and easy right now. I'm going to be turning the baton and the microphone over to my new friend and colleague, Andrew Weissman, who in turn will introduce our keynote speaker, Lisa Monaco. But before I do that, I just wanted to say a couple of thank yous. I wanted to thank the dean of the law school, Trevor Morrison, for his vision and for his support of the center. Trevor came to the deanship this summer bringing, among other things, expertise in national security law. So you can imagine for me and for Zach, it's been pretty awesome to have a boss who understands and cares about the issues as deeply as Trevor does. The second thank you I wanted to say is to Zach Goldman, to Sarvanaz Bakhtiar, and to the students who, as interns, are the worker bees who make the Center on Law and Security work, and they do so tirelessly. So Zach, Sarvanaz, and our interns, whose names I won't mention because I'm sure I'll forget someone, thank you so much. You've done a wonderful job today, and I think we all owe you a massive debt of gratitude. I also just wanted to say very briefly, I know many of you are veterans of Center on Law and Security programming, which is terrific, and we're glad to have you back in the room with us today. Some of you are new to our organization, so I wanted to say what I mentioned this morning, and some of you have already heard me say, in which case, thank you for indulgence, that our center really is trying to hone in on what we think of as the core issue set in this area. And that issue set is a moving target. If we were here meeting 4 years ago, we might have been having a very different conversation, even 2 years ago. Now, of course, given the events of this summer, this fall, we're thinking about the issues of national security through the lens of technology and surveillance and cyber. Our project at the Center on Law and Security is to try to do really what is, if not the impossible, at least the challenging, which is to keep the conversation between security and strategy on the one hand and law ongoing, and to keep it going in a way where law and strategy continue to have something serious to say to one another. And it's in that spirit that we're very fortunate to have fellows at the center who help anchor our programming and bring expertise from the outside to us at the center and help us interact with our students and interact with the world in a way that stays fresh and current and true to the issue set as it manifests itself in the world. So I'd like to mention our current fellows. First of all, you heard this morning from the former president of the Israeli Supreme Court, Dorit Beinish, who's the Weinstein family senior fellow at the Center on Law and Security. She and I co-teach a class devoted to the issue of how courts around the world adjudicate national security. Judy Germano recently joined us as our cyber fellow after a long and very distinguished career as a prosecutor. And Judy is helping us at the center think through the issue of how public and private entities necessarily come together in order to co-produce security in the cyber domain, which inevitably calls upon the expertise of public and private actors. And last and surely not least, Andrew Weissman, who joined our ranks only a month ago, having until recently served as the general counsel of the FBI, and before that, having enjoyed a storied career in the public and the private sectors. And so Andrew is going to introduce not just our very distinguished keynote speaker, but I believe his good friend, Lisa Monaco. I'll only say this about Lisa Monaco. If our center is really aspiring to, and I hope is succeeding at, trying to keep that dialogue going between strategy and law, there's really no better person in the United States than Lisa Monaco to offer her perspective and her wisdom on these issues. I just note very briefly, and I'm not going to steal your thunder, Andrew, I promise, Lisa's last two jobs, her previous job as the top national security lawyer within the Department of Justice, and her current job as the president's senior advisor on issues of homeland security and counterterrorism. If you just reflect on the fact that Lisa, in her very recent career, has sat in both of those positions and offered those two perspectives on the issues, I think you have a sense of why she's such a fitting keynote speaker for this afternoon. So thank you, and over to Andrew Weissman.
So I'm going to be extremely brief, and I'm going to, as Sam said, I'm going to introduce my good friend, Lisa Monaco. I have just come from Washington, and as many of you know, that term good friend has infinite elasticity in Washington, but she actually is a good friend. So I use that in the New York, not Washington sense. You can all look in your program and see the actually storied career that Lisa has had. She's gone to all of the right schools, and she since then has had an amazing career in the Department of Justice and now at the White House, starting out as a staffer on the Hill and now working for the president. But there are two things that you should know, because you can read the cold resume and think that this is just an amazing person and you'd be right. But two things, and although I'm known for hyperbole, there is no hyperbole in either of these things, that this past weekend at a cocktail party, a friend of mine in Washington who's a judge said, "Oh my God, you know Lisa Monaco? My son, who is a staffer, says that she is a god on the Hill for staffers, because she is somebody who has gone from being a worker bee on the Hill to having, you know, the most exalted position as a lawyer and as an advisor." And she is also a model for so many people in Washington, including myself, because in each of her incredible positions, she has consistently been the merit choice. And as I think you all know, that is not routinely something that you can describe for people. So she's somebody who brings an enormous amount of integrity and judgment and candor and apolitical judgment. And so we're extremely fortunate to have her here today and thank her very much, because I know there's always a lot going on in her current position. So it's terrific that she could come up and talk to us today. So with that, Lisa Monaco.
Well, thanks very much, Sam. Can folks hear me, if not see me, over the microphone, given my, well, that was very high praise, my diminutive stature may not match it. Thanks very much, Andrew. Very generous introduction and very generous remarks from Sam. It is great to be here. It's always a good rule of thumb to have a friend introduce you. So, and Andrew and I do go back a long way. I really want to thank the Center and NYU Law School, and of course Sam and Zach for inviting me. And it's great to be back with Dean Morrison. It kind of feels good to say, since I used to just call him Trevor. But it's great to be here. We're here today to discuss a critical topic at a critical time. And I want to thank everyone for inviting me. It's really terrific to be here. It strikes me that NYU's motto, and I'm not going to stumble over the Latin, is particularly appropriate for what we're here to talk about. To persevere and to excel. That motto reflects, I think, how the men and women of the counterterrorism community approach their mission every day. Protecting Americans at home and abroad is our first responsibility as a government, and it is the president's first responsibility as the commander-in-chief. And my job as the president's Homeland Security and Counterterrorism Advisor is to wake up each and every morning thinking about how to confront the array of transnational and unconventional threats that our nation faces. So many of you are drawn here today and to this topic because of what happened 12 years ago in this very proud city and at the Pentagon and in the skies above Pennsylvania. But for many in the NYU community, the attack on September 11th wasn't just a national tragedy. It was, in essence, a personal trauma. You lived it. And we can never forget the clouds of ash that blotted out a September sun, the twisted steel that scarred lower Manhattan, or the gaping hole left in so many hearts by the thousands who were lost. And that's why over the last 12 years and across two different administrations, thoughtful people have come together in settings just like these to help shape the response to the many challenges, legal, ethical, and strategic, as Sam highlighted, that we have faced in confronting evolving threats. And events like these have helped shape our national response. Today, I can tell you and report that this nation has developed an expertise in counterterrorism that is unequaled. We've persevered in our fight against extremism, and we've excelled at our mission to identify threats and to prevent attacks. Our approach reflects a comprehensive, and I would argue tailored, counterterrorism, or CT, strategy, one that draws on all elements of national power. This strategy must be precise, and it must be sustainable, and it cannot rely on open-ended war that drains our resources and risks undermining national consensus on combating terrorism. As President Obama recently said in a speech at the National Defense University, we must define our effort not as a boundless global war on terror, but rather as a series of persistent, targeted efforts to dismantle specific networks of violent extremists that threaten America. If we do that, I have no doubt that we can defend our nation and emerge even stronger. Now, we're at a law school, so it's appropriate to talk about the theory of the case. When it comes to confronting terrorism threats today, our theory of the case is about partnerships. This element of our strategy often gets lost in all the focus on direct action taken with drones or special operations forces. To succeed and to be sustainable, we need an approach that goes beyond direct action. And our strategy reflects a commitment to partner with host nations, with allies, and across the expertise in our own government to confront an increasingly diverse and diffuse terrorist threat. Now, that does not mean that we are taking our foot off the gas when it comes to pursuing terrorist groups that threaten our nation. Far from it. Far from scaling back our counterterrorism operations, our special operators, intelligence, and law enforcement professionals are more integrated and more effective than ever before. That integration and tempo of operations was on full display last month when, over the course of just a few days, the United States government executed a series of operations targeting specific threats, including an attempted capture of an al-Shabaab leader in Somalia and the successful capture of Abu Anas al-Libi, who was indicted for his alleged role in al-Qaeda's conspiracy to kill Americans, including the bombings of our embassies in Kenya and Tanzania 15 years ago. Now, these actions send the message loud and clear. We will use every tool at our disposal to prevent an attack against the United States or to go after those who seek to do us harm, no matter how long it takes. Now, today, I want to discuss the full range of activities we undertake to protect the American people. Because to disrupt, dismantle, and to defeat al-Qaeda, its affiliates, and adherents, while preserving American values, all of these pieces must fit together. Now, as this conference recognizes, we live in an era of evolving threats. A host of factors, from political upheaval in the Middle East to easy access to information, these have all spawned a more diverse terrorist threat than we faced more than a decade ago. The group that attacked us on 9/11, Core al-Qaeda, is a shadow of its former self, and we continue to degrade its capacity. While it remains intent on attacks against the homeland, its ability to mount a successful operation inside our borders is significantly diminished, thanks to the work of CT professionals from all over the world. Al-Qaeda Corps' leaders now spend more time hiding than plotting attacks. And in their place, more dispersed terrorist elements have taken on greater prominence in the fight. So who are these elements? First, there are the regional Al-Qaeda affiliates. Chief among them is Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, the most ambitious and active affiliate. It has tried and failed to attack the U.S. homeland three separate times. And it was a serious threat emanating from the Arabian Peninsula that prompted us to temporarily close our embassies in the region just this past summer. In Somalia, Al-Shabaab is under pressure, but still capable of sowing havoc, as we saw in the Westgate Mall attack in Nairobi earlier this fall. Some of its members remain committed to attacking the United States. Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb controlled parts of Mali last year, and figures connected to that group, like Mukhtar Belmukhtar, seek to terrorize innocent civilians, as we saw just last January in the hostage situation at the In Amenas gas plant. And we are deeply concerned about a spike in threats from Al-Qaeda in Iraq and groups like Al-Nusra Front in Syria that are intent on exploiting regional instability to gain a foothold in the Middle East. Syria is one of the most difficult CT challenges on the horizon, and it will require coordinated international action to resolve. Now, for the most part, the ambitions of these groups are regional, and attacks are localized. But they remain a very real threat to the United States and its interests. They may not yet be capable of conducting large-scale attacks against the U.S. homeland, but they are actively targeting American embassies, American assets, businesses, and citizens within their reach. A second category of threats are loosely aligned groups who are not Al-Qaeda affiliates, but who subscribe to Al-Qaeda's ideology. In recent years, these adherents have become increasingly active. They are opportunistic, leveraging economic and political instability in the Middle East and in Africa, porous borders awash with weapons, and the confluence of nationalism and extremism to advance their own objectives. And they are perfectly willing to use violence to achieve a political goal or to expand their territory. The clearest example here is the violent extremists in Libya. The Libyan people largely reject extremism, and they are working hard to throw off a legacy of dictatorship and to build a democratic government from the ground up. But strong institutions are not yet in place, including security forces, that can serve Libya's citizens. The United States is working to support progress in Libya, including with our NATO allies, to provide training to Libya's armed forces. But it's going to take years of steady effort and a lot of hard work. Meanwhile, extremist groups like Ansar al-Sharia are able to exploit the lack of strong institutions and to cause real damage. It was in this environment where terrorists attacked our facilities in Benghazi last year and killed four brave Americans. We remain concerned that the instability and extremist influence in the country exists, even as we recognize that we have a very good partner in Prime Minister Zaidan. The third category of threat is the most unpredictable: extremists who self-radicalize here in the United States, sometimes without any personal contact with Al-Qaeda, beyond perhaps consuming their online propaganda. Attacks like we saw in Boston last spring are not unstoppable, but the self-contained nature of this threat presents an added layer of difficulty for those who work nonstop to detect them. Now, that's not an exhaustive list of every terrorist group and threat that we're tracking. Iran and Lebanese Hezbollah operate around the globe. Boko Haram and Ansaru in West Africa, extremists in South and Southeast Asia, and we are always vigilant against domestic terrorism. But every terrorist group does not pose the same level of threat to the United States. As the threat has become decentralized, we must be disciplined in differentiating between groups that pose a threat where they exist and groups that have the will and the capacity to project power. But since 9/11, the threat is marked by more decentralization, more diverse actors, and more attacks of opportunism. So, how are we addressing this dynamic threat and this rather grim picture that I have painted? We are pursuing a multifaceted strategy that includes our military, diplomacy, financial action, intelligence, and law enforcement. And in each of these areas, we are building partnerships that span borders. Soldier to soldier, cop to cop, prosecutor to prosecutor, and diplomat to diplomat. In all that we do, we rely on a comprehensive legal framework that brings all tools to bear, law enforcement, military, and intelligence. And this is seen in our use of both Article III courts as well as reformed military commissions in appropriate cases. We gain valuable insights into the threats we face from intelligence collection using the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, as well as by executing search warrants and serving grand jury subpoenas. And while we conduct operations under the authorization for the use of military force overseas, we also draw on law enforcement relationships and tools like Interpol red notices to have terrorists arrested. Not every tool will be appropriate for every threat. But by integrating all these tools, we ensure that our counterterrorism strategy is flexible enough to adapt to the threats as they change. Now, direct military action is a vital aspect of our CT strategy. As President Obama has said, we will never hesitate to use force, including lethal force, if necessary, to protect the American people. We take lethal action against terrorists who pose a continuing, imminent threat to the United States and its people. But capture will always be the preferred course where feasible. And the President has shown his willingness to send in special operations units to capture individuals when a host nation cannot or will not take action. These actions are conducted under strong oversight. All strikes outside of Iraq and Afghanistan are briefed to the appropriate committees of Congress. The actions are also legal. Within a week of 9/11, Congress overwhelmingly passed the authorization for the use of military force. And as a matter of domestic and international law, the United States is at war with Al-Qaeda, the Taliban, and associated forces. The AUMF has been a vital source of authority, and it continues to be applicable to the threats we face today. Over time, though, we will need to ensure that our authorities reflect the specific needs of our current counterterrorism work. That's why the President is committed to working with Congress to refine and ultimately repeal the mandate of the AUMF. Now, CT direct action often dominates the headlines, and we've seen that. But it is only the proverbial tip of the spear. If there's one factor that has defined our success over the past 12 years, I would argue it's partnerships. Whether in Yemen or Iraq, Afghanistan or Pakistan, the Maghreb and Sahel, or in Europe, other governments often understand the root causes of terrorism in their countries and the weaknesses of our enemies much better than we do. They are often better positioned to provide sustained counterterrorism pressure. We can provide training and equipment and share information, but our partners bring a knowledge and legitimacy and a reach that amplifies our own efforts. These relationships help secure borders, degrade terrorist networks, and they take the fight to our enemies, wherever they hide. That's why we've built strong relationships to support every pillar of our counterterrorism architecture, starting with military cooperation. Now, that type of military cooperation that I'm referencing played out last year in North Africa when Al-Qaeda's branch in Africa, AQIM, or Al-Qaeda in the Islamic Maghreb, took control of much of North Mali. Mali's government was weakened by a recent coup, and loosely organized extremists were exploiting a power vacuum. They combined easy access to weapons with a warped ideology. They destroyed ancient treasures, including Muslim artifacts, and terrorized the local population. So, an international coalition led by France and including support from the US and partners in Europe, Africa, and the Middle East all worked with the Malian military to drive extremists out. The U.S. provided airlift and refueling support, and we continue to supply critical needs, including food and water and training, for more than 6,000 African soldiers and police who've been deployed since this successful international response began. This international partnership paved the way for safe elections and renewed stability in Mali, taking on both the immediate threat as well as the dire conditions that helped the extremists take hold in the first place. So that leads me to the second major pillar of our counterterrorism strategy, and that's our international engagement to isolate terrorist groups and deny them resources. The UN Al-Qaeda sanctions regime, established unanimously under a Security Council resolution, obligates member states to freeze the assets and prohibit the travel of Al-Qaeda associates. The Security Council has used this tool to impose sanctions on more than 220 individuals and 63 entities worldwide engaging in terrorism, raising funds, or providing other support to Al-Qaeda. The global consensus around these sanctions has limited the ability of bad actors to operate in the global financial system and, in many cases, to undertake terrorist acts across national borders. One individual, Suleiman Bougaith, who was a terrorist designated on the UN list and a prominent member of Al-Qaeda on 9/11, is a great example of how these strings are brought together. When he tried to surreptitiously transit the globe earlier this year, he was detected and detained by our partners, allowing us to bring him to the United States and to stand trial for his crimes. And last week, we announced that we've added Boko Haram and Ansaru, two deadly terror groups operating in Nigeria, to those designated as foreign terrorist organizations. This is another step in cutting off funding and other forms of support for emerging terrorist threats. Of course, one of the most essential tools for tracking and disrupting terrorist plots is reliable intelligence and the partnerships that allow us to share it. That's the third pillar of our counterterrorism structure. Our strong intelligence cooperation with other nations is absolutely essential when it comes to taking on transnational terrorist networks, a fact our foreign partners recognize as well as we do. So while public debate surrounds the recent unauthorized intelligence disclosures, we should not ignore the value of the U.S. intelligence community, including the National Security Agency, in combating terrorism. Intelligence programs save lives. They help disrupt terrorist cells abroad before they can strike at our closest allies, and they allowed the FBI's Joint Terrorism Task Force and the NYPD right here in New York to capture the New York City subway bomber before he could execute his plan. The dedication of the men and women of our intelligence community, including at the NSA, is a significant reason that we have enjoyed relative security since 9/11. We cannot afford to relinquish this tool any more than we would sacrifice our military advantage. So, even as we take necessary steps to review our intelligence programs and ensure they're appropriately tailored and have the right level of policy oversight, we also need to preserve our capability to protect our nation. We are committed to striking the right balance between securing Americans and our allies and the privacy concerns that all people share. Now, law enforcement and criminal justice and the community that those two represent is something I know a little something about, as Sam and Andrew have referenced. This is the fourth pillar in our CT structure. I witnessed at the FBI and at the Department of Justice how those two institutions transformed from exclusively law enforcement agencies to vital and active elements of our national security structure. From the National Security Division that I had the privilege to lead before coming to the White House, to the Department of Homeland Security and the National Counterterrorism Center, we have created institutions where professionals sit side by side and work together to better share their expertise. So the idea that we could ever return to a pre-9/11 approach to counterterrorism is not only wrong, it's downright impossible. A clear example of this is the capture at sea and the successful prosecution of an individual named Ahmed Warsami. It's a textbook case of how we draw on the strengths of our counterterrorism pillars and bring them together to deliver results, and in this case, to deliver justice. Warsami was al-Shabaab's liaison to AQAP in Yemen. Our intelligence community identified him and tracked him, and at the right time, while he was in transit between Yemen and Somalia, our military captured him and held him for 2 months for interrogation, gaining a trove of new intelligence on two major al-Qaeda affiliates. Afterwards, he was Mirandized and indicted by a grand jury right here in New York. But he chose to continue speaking with the FBI, providing further valuable intelligence in exchange for a plea deal. Ultimately, he was charged and pleaded guilty. And it was intelligence, carefully gathered over a period of years and fed to special operators, as well as close coordination with the FBI, that landed Abu Anas al-Libi in a New York courtroom just last month. Finally, our strategy depends on diplomatic and civilian assistance for our partners. Across the Middle East and North Africa, and in countries undergoing transition all over the world, our diplomats and development experts are working around the clock to help our partners better serve the needs and aspirations of their people. Yemen is probably the best example of how we have helped improve a partner's counterterrorism capacity while also supporting political reform that's aimed at making that government more responsive and accountable to its citizens. Since 2009, we've invested nearly $400 million in training and equipping the Yemeni military, including their specialized counterterrorism units. It was a highly effective Yemeni offensive last year that helped drive AQAP out of communities and gave the Yemeni people the courage and confidence to rise up. But just as important as our counterterrorism goals are, the Yemenis are leading a historic national dialogue to chart a more just and democratic future for their country, an effort that I discussed just yesterday with President Hadi of Yemen. The United States has provided support to Yemen's political transition, including its preparations for constitutional reform, national elections, and ensuring that women and youth and civil society are all active participants in the national dialogue. And at the same time, we're providing humanitarian assistance to relieve a growing crisis caused by a lack of access to clean food and to clean water. Looking toward a more stable and prosperous future for all Yemen, for all the people of Yemen, the U.S. is investing to help spur economic growth over the long term. Now, despite our many successes, the unfortunate truth is that there will always be another threat. Killing Osama bin Laden and degrading core al-Qaeda does not put an end to terrorism or our focus against it. Terrorists will continue to attack our diplomatic facilities, our businesses, our citizens, and we know al-Qaeda core and its affiliates like AQAP remain determined to attack here at home. We also see the potential for direct threats to emerge from new directions, particularly from al-Qaeda-linked groups in Syria, which are gaining strength in the midst of a protracted conflict between rebel forces and the Assad regime. So our counterterrorism strategy not only focuses on detecting and defeating threats, it seeks to bolster the resilience we show as a people. That means that we recognize and accept the risks of being present and engaged around the world, even as we work to protect all those who represent our country abroad. It also means recognizing that homeland security is more than just taking your shoes off when you fly. It's about how we prevent, mitigate, respond to, and recover from emergencies, whether it's a terrorist attack or a natural hazard like a hurricane, a flood, or a tornado. In Boston and New York, in West Texas and Moore, Oklahoma, across the Jersey Shore, and in communities all across this great country, we've seen Americans come together to rebuild their lives after a tragedy. Think about the neighbors nearby here who worked together to muck out their homes after Hurricane Sandy. Remember the everyday citizens who became extraordinary heroes when the bombs went off in Boston, running into the smoke, confusion, and fear to help. The refusal to be terrorized, the readiness to rebuild, That's resilience. And that's what we're working to build into every layer of our society. That's why the final pillar of our counterterrorism architecture is also this country's greatest asset, our people, and the values that we stand for. Community connections are the bedrock of our resilience to terrorist threats, and we rely on strong community engagement to prevent attacks before they can take place. By working together, we can intervene with individuals a community identifies as in danger of radicalizing before they become a threat. Those in Al-Qaeda and other extremist groups perpetuate a warped vision of the world, where Muslims and the United States are locked in a perpetual conflict, and where basic rights and liberties aren't shared equally. As we actively refute this ideology in public forums around the world and online, we also strive to project the power of our most deeply held values in word and in deed. Part of that effort depends upon turning the page on elements of the post-9/11 period, which is why we remain committed to closing the prison in Guantanamo Bay, which has become a drain on our resources and a polarizing symbol around the world. In this job, people often ask me what keeps me up at night. As I've outlined today, there are many out there who wish to do us harm around the world and here at home, as we saw last spring in Boston. The Boston Marathon bombings happened within my very first few weeks on my current job, and it was the nightmare scenario. And it happened in my hometown. It was an around-the-clock effort to track down perpetrators and help the city of Boston regain its sense of security. Today, though, rather than what keeps me up, I'd like to end by telling you what helps me sleep. And that is my complete faith in the men and women who have dedicated their lives to this nation. From the intelligence analyst sifting through data to find the critical clue, to the special operations sergeant risking his life to help one of our partners succeed, to the prosecutors and the judges and the cops who serve justice back home. They persevere. They excel. There's no such thing as 100% security or certainty in counterterrorism work. Still, we make progress each and every day to undermine the conditions where terrorists can operate. There are numerous silent victories. We've built a robust counterterrorism architecture to meet the threats we face today, and with your help, the new threats that we'll face in the future. Thanks very much.
So if you have questions for Lisa, we have a few minutes for that. So if you go up to the microphone.
Thank you. My name is Gabor Rona. I'm legal director at Human Rights First. I have a question about the kind of next generation of counterterrorism interdiction. You mentioned the Warsami case, and we've talked some about this, the idea of a Warsami model for future counterterrorist actions. And I wonder, is there a concerted position within the administration about whether the idea of capturing terrorist suspects abroad, providing them with no judicial process abroad, bringing them into the United States for prosecution, where our courts have shown no indication to make determinations about the legitimacy of the initial grab. Does that depend on the continuity of a wartime model, or is that consistent in the administration's view with a peacetime model of counterterrorism?
So I'm going to borrow from Sam Raskoff, and so we can get as many in as possible. Why don't I ask, let's cluster these. So if the next questioner can ask your question as well.
Hi, my name is Jake Walter Warner. You mentioned that as part of the CT strategy, you've helped build up Yemen's counterterrorism regime. And I was wondering how, if anything, helping allies build up their CT strategy has changed in light of Pakistan and the ISI and realizing that they're funding the Haqqani network, which attacks Americans in Afghanistan and helped shield bin Laden and all the aid that we had given them over the years. Thank you.
Hi there. My name is David Leapart. I'm a third-year law student here. Like many of my colleagues, I've sort of grown up under this authorized use of military force in the war on terror and seen the executive sort of counterterrorism toolbox grow to places that we'd never sort of contemplated before. And I was overjoyed last year before the election to see President Obama sort of working on what a rule book would look like in case he wasn't always sort of in the Oval Office as we know he can be. So I'm sort of curious as to what other sort of limiting structures the administration is working on for when we don't have a liberal constitutional law professor who's pulling the trigger on the drones. Thank you.
Well, let me respond to a few of these while we have a minute. On the Warsami question, a few things there. I think while that is something that has been referenced as a model, I think it is not unique in one sense, which is, and from my experience in the Justice Department, I know well, which is the United States government has used the criminal justice process to secure the presence in a United States courtroom of fugitives from justice or individuals who are abroad and under indictment or under a criminal complaint for many, many years. So that is not a tremendous deviation. But what I would say about what's been referred to as the Warsami model is it reflects, I think, two things. One is the preference for capture that the president has talked about, and I referenced in my speech, that wherever feasible, we will seek to disrupt a continuing imminent threat or a threat to our to the United States and to our people through capture. And then the other is a preference at to obtain intelligence when that is done. And that's what you saw reflected in the Warsami operation, and that's the fusion that happened with regard to intelligence professionals coming together with military, coming together with prosecutors. That was present in both the Warsami case and in the al-Libi case that I mentioned. And on the rule book, I think what you see reflected there and in a whole range of approaches that the president has taken is to ask and force us to ask not just what is the legal floor, what is legally permissible, but what is, from a policy perspective, the thing that we should be doing? And those are two questions we're regularly asking ourselves on a whole host of issues.
I'm Mario Loyola. Thank you for the opportunity to engage in this important discussion. Early in the Obama administration, when the decision was made to send Khalid Sheikh Mohammed and some of the other 9/11 plotters to civilian court in New York, the decision was also made to send the Cole bombers to military commission. And when Attorney General Holder was asked to explain the basis for distinguishing between the two groups, he gave an answer which I can only be charitably described as incredible, which is that because the 9/11 bombers had attacked a civilian target, they should go to civilian court, and because the Cole bombers had attacked a military target, they should go to a military court. That answer is incredible because it creates a huge incentive for terrorists to attack civilian, defenseless civilians instead of hardened military targets.
Could I ask you to
the question
ask
is,
your questions to
yeah,
the next
so,
person?
So the obvious question is, what is the administration, since that can't possibly be the administration's statement for distinguishing between the two groups, what is the administration's policy for distinguishing between the two groups?
So I'll just respond to that quickly, which is that in every instance where there is a threat that is posed, and we saw this play out in Warsami, in al-Libi, and in other cases, the national security team comes together to make a determination, and this goes to the tools that I talked about in my speech, to determine what is the best tool to use to disrupt a particular threat. Is it intelligence? Is it diplomacy? Is it a military operation? Is it the criminal justice process? Is it a military prosecution? That has happened time and again throughout the last several years. And those decisions are made based on a host of factors, not unlike the types of prosecutorial decisions that get made every day when you're distinguishing between a state prosecution and a federal prosecution. So really what I would say is the approach is one, what is the best tool that's going to be available to disrupt a particular threat? and the military commissions as reformed in the Military Commissions Act in 2009 is a valid, viable, and legitimate tool to use, in my view.
Yes, I think the last question.
Hi, Letta Taylor from Human Rights Watch, author of a recent report on U.S. targeted killings in Yemen. It's a real pleasure to hear your speech today. And Human Rights Watch truly welcomes President Obama's new policy guidelines on targeted killings. What we would love to hear from you and others in the administration is which of these policies were implemented prior to the president's speech, if any, and where and more or less when? Because our research has indicated that prior to the president's speech, these policy guidelines were not being followed in at least six cases that I looked at in Yemen, for example. So we're wondering, is that because they were not applied yet, or was there a mistake made in those instances? Thanks very much.
Thanks, thanks for your question and for the work on your report. What I would say is the policy guidance that the president announced in May and that was featured in the speech that he gave at the National Defense University reflected a desire to both memorialize and institutionalize a set of approaches and standards for the use of direct action outside of Afghanistan, outside of the so-called hot battlefield. And there was a commitment reflected there to ensure that there was a process going forward and that documented, in some respects, a process and standards that were in place at the time for a heightened standard to apply for the use of direct action. And it was referenced in my speech about the continuing imminent threat standard, the standard for no non-combatant deaths, and a host of other standards that bring these practices more in line with international law, and a commitment in the president's speech to as much transparency as possible around these issues consistent with our national security. So I think what you saw in that speech and in the documents that we released around it and in the Attorney General's letter at the time regarding the Alaki strike, we're all in effort to put as much transparency and clarity around those processes as possible.
So join me in thanking again Lisa Monaco.